Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you.
And also with you.
A very warm and loving welcome as we meet together to encourage each other, as we worship God and find our own encouragement in His presence. We meet this on the seventh Sunday in ordinary time. And our theme for today, the Lord of the storm, with us always and everywhere.
Give thanks to the Lord, for He is good, for His steadfast love endures forever. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty. The night has passed and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this new day, So may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
We come from scattered lives to meet with God, who assures us of his forgiveness in word as we read. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls.
Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Lord, have mercy.
May the God of love and power forgive you and free you from your sins, heal and strengthen you in his Spirit, and raise you to new life in Christ Jesus our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
May we, a forgiven people, marvel at God's greatness as we praise him, the Lord who is enthroned in heavenly splendor.
Thank you. The first reading is taken from 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verses 1 to 13. As we work together with him, we urge you also not to accept the grace of God in vain. For he says, "At an acceptable time I have listened to you, and on a day of salvation I have helped you. See, now is the acceptable time. See, now is the day of salvation. We are putting no obstacle in anyone's way, so that no fault may be found with our ministry. But as servants of God, we have commended ourselves in every way, through great endurance, in afflictions, hardships, calamities, beatings, imprisonments, riots, labors, sleepless nights, hunger, by purity, knowledge, patience, kindness, holiness of spirit, genuine love, truthful speech, and the power of God, with the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and for the left, in honor and dishonor, in ill repute and good repute. We are treated as impostors and yet are true, as unknown and yet are well known, as dying and see we are alive, as punished and yet not killed, as sorrowful yet always rejoicing, as poor yet making many rich, as having nothing and yet possessing everything. We have spoken frankly to you, Corinthians. Our heart is wide open to you. There is no restriction in our affections, but only in yours. In return, I speak as to children. Open wide your hearts also. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The second reading is taken from St. Mark chapter 4, verses 35 to 41. On that day when evening had come, he said to them, "Let us go across to the other side," and leaving the crowd behind, they took him with them in the boat just as he was. Other boats were with him. A great windstorm arose, and the waves beat into the boat so that the boat was already being swamped. But he was in the stern asleep on the cushion. And they woke him up and said to him, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" He woke up and rebuked the wind and said to the sea, "Peace, be still." Then the wind ceased and there was a dead calm. He said to them, "Why are you afraid? Have you still no faith?" And they were filled with great awe and said to one another, "Who then is this? Even the wind and sea obey him." This is the word of the Lord.
Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, my strength and our Redeemer. Amen. The Gospel according to St. Mark, chapter 4 and verse 38. But he was in the stern asleep on the cushion, and they woke him up and said, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" As most of the world is caught up in the storm caused by the global health crisis, I believe if there was ever an appropriate and timely passage for us to draw comfort and direction from, then the narrative containing Jesus calming the storm may be one of the most appropriate narratives for us to reflect on. We meet Jesus having taught his hearers about the kingdom of God in the parable leading into this. And we see here Jesus now going on to open the eyes of his disciples in order that they may know him more clearly and follow him more dearly. Mission and ministry are never static. I say this because of what we discover in Jesus. Jesus who keeps moving from the people-based setting to a place where he could be alone with his disciples. Therefore, the reason to go from one place to the other becomes necessary. In this instance, the other side meant the other side of the Sea of Galilee. It was not just a change of place, but it was an opening for his closest associates to discover and experience something new in God's power over nature. Now, the Sea of Galilee is also called the Sea of Tiberias or the Lake Gennesaret. This is 21 kilometers long and 11 kilometers wide. It's also situated below sea level and therefore often the subject to violent storms when there would be a big buildup of wind from the surrounding hills that stir up the waters. Records tell us that as recently as in 1992, a storm sent up to 3-meter waves, that is 10-foot waves, crashing into the modern day town of Tiberias. As Jesus and his disciples cross the lake by boat, we read that a great windstorm, perhaps like what we experienced in the recent past here, caused large waves eventually that began to break against the boat in which the disciples with Jesus was riding, threatening the lives of all of them who were present in the boat with Jesus. In fact, in the last few days and weeks, I have been carefully following the developments of the maritime disaster that took place just outside the seaport here in Colombo. And a comment I heard from an expert made on the environment is that the sea has a mind of its own. And if for in our day and age today, if forces of nature were strong enough to obstruct salvage ships and tugs trying to deal with the fire on board this massive container ship outside Colombo, we can then just imagine what it would have been like for Jesus and his friends who were in a simple boat as they traveled across the lake in the midst of this furious or violent storm. Jesus was probably exhausted after a tired, long day of teaching, and so naturally fast asleep. His terrified disciples wake him up, and with it we discover the first of 4 questions that are being asked in this text that are key for us to understand this entire incident. The first question appears in verse 37 when the disciples asked, "Teacher, do you not care that we are perishing?" The question is one that seems to stem from their fear. And Jesus responds to that by calming the storm. The second question then comes, and this second question is also key for us to understand this incident. Verse 40 says, Jesus asks the question, "Why are you afraid?" It is not that they doubted his care for them, but they became, we discover, victims of fear. We know very well what fear does to us when we are overcome by it. Just like the fear that paralyzed the Jews when they saw the Philistine warrior named Goliath, these disciples were paralyzed with fear in the face of the storm that prevailed. And they realized that they were in danger of shipwreck, and their chances of survival were very grim. Most of us fully understand that fear of physical danger has a crippling effect over us. There are different types of fears and phobias to the fears that are deeply rooted in our cultures. You see, if you are very close with culture, you will realize there are certain things that we don't engage in because of these fears, because of these phobias. So we don't have, culturally in this part of the world, people are reluctant to have funerals on Tuesdays and Fridays. Culturally, people are very hesitant to see a doctor on the first working day of a month. We will hear of people who are reluctant to leave the house if a single crow flies over them. There are people who are very unhappy and very superstitious because of the fears they have over the number 13. I remember an instance where a driver did not want to drive the vehicle because the number totaled up to 13. And then if you are familiar with the game of cricket, I'm quite sure you have seen that famous umpire who skips when it comes to the number, when the score comes to 111, if it's in England, and he skips to when the score comes to 87, if they are playing in Australia. So these fears and anxieties and phobias have an amazing way of controlling us. Fears that are deeply rooted in culture also cause great stress and anxiety. And in fact, it can become a living nightmare to many. The third of the four questions, which are key to our understanding the incident, captures Jesus' challenge to the disciples, again in verse 40. "Do you still have no faith?" he asks. We discover Jesus encouraging us to look to our faith first and not be overcome with our fears. In other words, faith should come first and not fear. The disciples were silent as they were experiencing a kind of fear that was more of a blend of terror and awe. On one hand, they felt fearful and terrorized by what was happening on the lake. And on the other hand, they were in awe of what they were seeing their master do. And so we observe them, from which we derive, and in our observation we derive the fourth question, as they looked with utter astonishment at one another and Jesus and asked, "Who is this? Who is this? That even the winds and the wave obey him." This was the same type of fear that we discover expressed when the disciples discovered Jesus walking on water. Mark chapter 6, verse 50 would say, "For they all saw him and were terrified. But immediately he spoke to them and said, 'Take heart, it is I, do not be afraid.'" If you remember at the Transfiguration, Mark chapter 9, verse 6, when they saw, the scripture says, Peter did not know what to say, for they were terrified. And again, Mark chapter 16, verse 8, at the empty tomb, again, this is articulated and expressed. As Mark records, "So they went out and fled from the tomb, for terror and amazement had seized them. And they said nothing to anyone, for they were afraid." In all of these instances, the disciples became aware that they were in the presence of someone who was truly unlike anyone else whom they had met or moved around with or known. This was someone special, and this Jesus was one with divine powers. This awareness would have been emphasized or driven home when Jesus calmed the storm with the words, "Be still," or as verse 39 records, "Peace." This echoes the words of the psalmist, who in Psalm 46, verse 10 would write, "Be still and know that I am God." Jesus' power over the wind and the waves may have reminded the disciples of the story that we have heard, that they have heard of old, of how Jesus came to the aid of his people and did the impossible as he parted the waters of the Red Sea to free his people from bondage as they fled in Egypt. So what do we learn from the boat ride in the storm? Jesus used the incident to help his disciples understand his power and authority transcended everything, including nature and natural law. Christ, therefore, is our lifeguard. He is our lifeboat and the one who we need to have confidence in, even as we journey through a storm in life right now. He was the go-to option for the disciples in their time of fear and chaos. Who is our go-to option today in the chaos and the turmoil we find ourselves today? What is our go-to option as we grapple with the chaos of our times, the anxiety that this global health crisis has put us in? To add to it, we are struggling with incompetent persons in authority and in leadership who just seem to be compounding one error over the other. And so we realize that there, as much as there must be one captain on board the vessel whose voice we need to listen to, we in life cannot have many captains and many voices whom we are going to turn to and listen. We need to remember and to rediscover God's presence in Jesus Christ in the midst of the storms that we are in today. rediscover him by being still in his presence. As we remain quiet before God, let's remind ourselves of what the songwriter reminds of us. Be still in the presence of the Lord, for he comes to heal, he comes to bring peace, he comes to bring order out of chaos. We may be today in our own storm of life. Maybe uncertainty to our jobs or something that is very close to us, triggered off by the global health crisis. Maybe we are battling an illness, and life is all of a sudden uncertain. And so may we remind ourselves that we look to the Lord, who in the midst of the storm said, "Be still, peace." The same Lord speaks to us in order to bring peace to our lives. Lord our God, we thank you for your word, and we thank you for all it teaches us. As we draw from the teaching of your word, in order to find direction, meaning, and purpose to life, help us to place you above our fears, and help us to turn to you as always to be our go-to option in the time of our fear and chaos. For this we pray and we ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Be thou my vision, O Lord of my heart.
Let us pray. Our ever-loving God, We give you thanks for our church family and bring before you our Bishop Dushantha, Archdeacon Father Perry, Assistant Curates Father Maxwell and Father Bala, as they guide us, teaching us your word and guiding us in your path. We pray that all may find here their true home, and that the lonely, the marginalized, and the rejected may be welcomed and loved in the name of Jesus. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Loving Father, may the nations hear your voice and know that you are God, supreme among the nations and supreme all over the world. We pray for those who are sick, for those who are afflicted with coronavirus, and for those with other illnesses as well. We pray for your healing hand to touch every one of them, that they may receive your healing according to your will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, you have given us the right to be called children of God. Help us to show your love in our homes, that they may be places of love, security, and truth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, we pray for our nation and our leaders and those in positions of authority, that they reject misusing their powers, but will govern this, our land, with integrity and wisdom, respecting and caring for all their people. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, we pray for those who have departed this life and recognize that they have been saved through their faith and the gift of your Son, Jesus Christ, rather than by the good works that they did and the things that they achieved in their time on earth. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Faithful God, you are rich in mercy and love us even when we sin and fail you. Thank you that by grace we have been saved and given the promise of being raised up with your Son, Jesus Christ, and seated with him in the heavenly places when we come to the end of our lives. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord, may those who have waited for you and hoped in your word know your steadfast love face to face. We offer unto you our hopes and fears, our joys and sorrows, to you, God, who will always be our refuge and strength. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Hasten, O Father, the coming of thy kingdom, and grant that we and all thy servants may be quickened together in thy eternal fellowship of the Holy Spirit. May with joy behold your Son at his coming again in glorious majesty, even Jesus Christ, our only mediator.
Amen. Come, Lord Jesus.
May we continue in prayer. Keep us, good Lord, under the shadow of your mercy. Sustain and support the anxious. Be with those who care for the sick, and lift up all who are brought low, that we may find comfort knowing that nothing can separate us from your love in Christ Jesus, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The collect for the day. O God, our protector and defender, storms rage about us and insidious disasters are unleashed unexpectedly in our midst and cause us to be afraid. Rescue us from despair and deliver your children from fear and insecurity. Preserve us all from unbelief and lack of hope in such circumstances. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The collect for peace. O God, the author of peace and the lover of concord, to know you is eternal life, to serve you is perfect freedom. Defend us, your servants, from all assaults of our enemies, that we may trust in your defense and not fear the power of any adversaries, through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
The collect for grace. Almighty and everlasting God, we thank you that you have safely brought us to the beginning of this day. Keep us from falling into sin or running into any kind of danger. Order us in all our doings and guide us to do what is right in your eyes. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
Rejoicing in God's new creation, as our Saviour taught us, so we pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power and the glory are yours, now and forever.
Amen.
The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your heart and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and always.
Amen. Amen.
Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
May we return to the pilgrimage of our lives, and may we do so in the confidence of God being our guardian and our guide.